Senate will please come to order. I ask all to rise and repeat the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
In the absence of silence, thank you. Senator Klein.
President, at this time, can we please recognize Senator Serrano?
Senator Serrano.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Senator Klein. As we all know here in this chamber, we lost an esteemed former senator, a true pioneer, a wonderful, loving colleague in Olga Mendez, who passed away last week. People use that term, pioneer, but she was much more than that. Yes, it's true. She opened doors for all of us, for people like myself, to even dream of being an elected official. She was a fighter, a true fighter for her community, but she never lost her human touch. And some may not expect to hear this from me because we were opponents, but that was the beauty of Olga. That it was never personal. It was about her community. And we fought a very respectful campaign, but she was always so loving to me and always so kind to me. And after it was all over, we became good friends and would speak on the phone quite regularly, and she would give me advice, mainly about the need to work in a bipartisan fashion, which I tried to do. With Olga, it was never personal. It was about love, it was about caring, it was about helping everyone in her community. And she was cared about so deeply by so many. And Olga had a special way of being able to use her charm, her wit, her personality, her intelligence to get things done that needed to get done for her community. So I will spend the rest of my career endeavoring to live up to her legacy. Olga Mendez, a trailblazer in every sense of the word, a loving, caring individual whose heart knew no bounds, who graced this chamber for many years with charm, and just people just loved to be around her. I miss Olga. My condolences go out to her family and to everyone in the East Harlem, South Bronx community who is mourning her loss. I miss you, Olga. I love you. God bless you and rest in peace. Can I ask for a moment of silence?
Senator Huntley.
Yes, Mr. President. At this time, I would like to offer condolences to Senator Ruth Hassel Thompson, who lost her mom. And I just want her to know that her mom was a fantastic person, did a lot in the community, well-respected, well-loved, and was in her 90s, which is a great life to live. And knowing Ruth, and all her stamina and her go-get'em, you know, her mom taught her a lot. And I just want to say to Ruth that, you know, she has my condolences, the condolences of my family, and I would like to offer a moment of silent prayer for her mom.
Of silence for Delesta Taylor Hassel, the mother of our Senator Ruth Hassel Thompson. Senator Diaz.
Thank you, Mr. President. I just want to speak on the loss of Senator Olga Mendez. You know, we human, we have the tradition of speaking good about a person when they are dead. After they are dead, we all speak how good, how decent, how great the person was. But during their lifetime, we don't even care. We don't even notice that. And one of those occasions is Olga Mendez. You got to see how many politicians, how many people are speaking so good about Olga Mendez. How many elected officials attended her services. And that should be a lesson for our community. A lesson that our community should learn. When Olga Mendez switched party and she became Republican, we all cursed her, we all jumped on her, we all went after her with passion. And we spoke so ill about her. And we did so many things against her because she switched party. We never remember all the 30 plus years, the good things she did, the fighter that she was, the committed that she was for our community. And the day that she lost the election, that was the day that the community lost her. The community didn't lose her the other day when she died. Our community lost Olga Mendez when she lost the election. And we knew the fighter she was. We knew how great she was. We knew how committed she was to our community. But it doesn't care. If you change your party, you're dead. And that should be a lesson to our community. And I was one of those elected officials in her services this week, some Monday. And I sat in there and I said, man, what a bunch of hypocrites we all are. Now we, sorry that we lost her. I went to see her at the hospital and I prayed with her while she was in the hospital. And I said to myself, we lost a great leader, a great senator, a great fighter from our community. Not the day that she died, the day that she lost her election, just because she changed her party. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Diaz. I'd remind all the members that there'll be a more fitting tribute, a more permanent tribute in September when we come back in session. So, Senator Volker.
Yeah, very quickly, I just want to say, first of all, commending Senator Hazel Thompson for being here. There aren't too many people who would have lost a mother so recently that would have the dedication to be here, and I want to commend you for being here very much. The second thing I just want to say is I spoke with Olga earlier this year after she received the notice on the Senate Club, and she was really very, very weak then, and she said, Dale, I have to tell you, I just don't think I'm not going to be able to make it, but I want you to tell everyone up there that I miss them, and I love the Senate. Just one final thing about that, though. I think those of us that knew Olga realized what the problem was, and it's an example for a lot of people. Olga Mendez was an extremely heavy smoker. I mean, extremely heavy. And unfortunately, a lot of us tried to say to her, Olga, you know, she was ill for a long time. You've got to deal with this because it'll eventually do you in. And I just want to mention that because she did what she wanted to do, but I don't think there's any question if it wasn't for her heavy smoking, she'd still be with us. And she was a wonderful person.
I'm going to go right to the reading of the journal. Skip going. The reading of the journal.
In Senate, Wednesday, August 5, the Senate met pursuant to adjournment. The journal of Tuesday, August 4, was read and approved on motion. Senate adjourned.
Without objection, the journal stands approved as read. Presentation of petitions, messages from the Assembly, messages from the Governor, reports of standing committees, reports of select committees, motions, and resolutions. Senator Klein.
Mr. President, I have two motions. First, on behalf of Senator Stavisky, I wish to call up calendar number 911, assembly print number 6391.
So ordered.
No. Secretary will read.
Secretary will read.
Calendar number 911 by member of the assembly, Glick. Assembly print number 6391, an act relating to reporting.
I now move to reconsider the vote by which this bill, assembly bill, was submitted for Senate print number 3603 on July 16th.
Call the roll of reconsideration.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skelos, Smith, Young, ayes 55.
I now move that Assembly Bill 6391 be recommitted to the Committee on Rules, and the Senate bill will be recommitted to the Committee on Rules.
The bill is before the House and restored to its place on the third reading calendar.
Mr. President, on behalf of Senator Breslin, I wish to call up Senate print number 2088, recall from the Assembly, which is now at the desk.
Secretary will read.
Calendar number 50 by Senator Breslin, Senate print 2088, an act to amend the insurance law.
Call the roll on reconsideration.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skelos, Smith, Young, ayes 55.
Mr. President, I now move to reconsider the vote by which the bill was passed.
Bill is before the House.
Mr. President, I now move to recommit the bill to the Committee on Rules.
So ordered. Senator Klein.
Mr. President, can we now at this time take up privileged Senate Resolution number 2949, which is at the desk. I ask that the title be read and move for its immediate adoption.
Secretary will read.
By Senator Sampson, Senate Resolution number 2949, providing for a select committee on New York City school governance.
Senator Sampson.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I just rise in support of this resolution, in support of the issue of school governance and putting a committee together to make sure that we monitor the progress with respect to school governance bill. And I look forward for my colleagues on both sides of the aisle working together to ensure that we continue the progress for our 1.1 million children in the city of New York, but most of all, making sure that the parental involvement and the voices are heard with respect to our constituencies. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Sampson. Are there any other senators wishing to be heard?
Perkins.
Senator Perkins.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise also to express my support of this resolution. You know, the public school system in New York City is presently under what has come to be known as mayoral control, but in effect has been about mayoral dictatorship. And I support this resolution because I believe that it provides us with an opportunity to end that type of dictatorship, to end that raw political approach that's been taken to the public school education for our children in New York City that has created a whole lot of havoc and controversy. So to the extent that this select committee has value, hopefully that value will be to curb the excessive use of the influence of the mayor in the policies that have shown themselves not to have been good for the children of the city of New York. In fact, just this week, the Times reported that the gap between children of color, black children, Latino children, and white children has not in any way diminished. This is in the era of the 100th anniversary of the NAACP, in the era when we are expecting to see a more enlightened approach to education. We are seeing something quite the opposite. So I look forward to working with this committee and hope that it will get passed.
We're listening to someone, Senator Perkins, talking about a resolution. I don't see any on my desk. I don't even know what we're talking about then. There's nothing on our desk, at least mine or the people next to me. I think if we're going to be discussing something, I think we ought to have the courtesy of having that resolution in front of us.
I'm there, so you're satisfied, Senator Larkin. Senator Larkin, are you satisfied?
I have a copy.
Thank you, Senator Larkin. The question is on the resolution. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Nay.
The resolution is adopted.
Senator Klein.
Mr. President, can we at this time take up Senate Resolution Number 2933 by Senator Diaz? I ask that the title be read and move for its immediate adoption and allow Senator Diaz to speak on his said resolution.
Secretary Reed.
By Senator Diaz, Legislative Resolution Number 2933, commemorating the 52nd Annual German-American Steuben Parade.
The question is on the resolution. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye. Opposed? Nay. The resolution is adopted. Senator Klein.
Mr. President, there will be an immediate meeting of the Finance Committee in the Majority Conference Room, followed by an immediate meeting of the Rules Committee in the Majority Conference Room. Pending the return of the Rules Committee, can we please stand at ease?
There will be an immediate meeting of the Finance Committee in the Majority Conference Room 332, followed by a meeting of the Rules Committee. The Senate will stand at ease pending these two committee reports. Senator Klein.
Mr. President, if we could return to the order of the reports of standing committees. I believe there is a report of the Rules Committee at the desk.
Senator Klein, there is a report of the Rules Committee here at the desk. The Secretary will read.
Senator Smith from the Committee on Rules reports the following bills. Restored, Assembly Print 8956A by member of the Assembly Weinstein, an act to amend the civil practice law and rules. Reported, Senate Prints 5968 by Senator Sampson, an act to amend the Family Court Act. 6104 by Senator DeLon, an act to amend the education law. 6105 by Senator Serrano, an act to amend the education law. 6106 by Senator Adams, an act to amend the education law. 6107 by Senator Huntley, an act to amend the education law. And Senate Print 5887 by Senator Padovan, an act to amend the education law. All bills ordered direct to third reading.
I move to adopt the Rules Committee report.
Report of the Rules Committee, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Report of the Rules Committee is adopted. Senator Klein.
Mr. President, I believe there's a report of the Judiciary Committee at the desk.
Senator Klein, there is a report of the Judiciary report at the desk. The Secretary will read.
By Senator Sampson from the Committee on Judiciary reports the following nomination. As a judge of the Court of Claims, Mark D. Cohen of Stony Brook.
Senator Sampson.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. This is a reappointment for the Honorable Mark Cohen from Suffolk County, who was here last month. I had time to speak to him. He did come before the committee. Due to a prearranged vacation schedule, he could not be here today, but he did report before the committee. He was in attendance the last go around, and I would like to move his nomination.
Are there any other senators wishing to be heard? Senator Maziarz.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. As the ranking member of the Judiciary Committee, I just want to thank the chairman, Senator Sampson. Mr. Cohen did appear before the committee. Was more than qualified. Has done a great job as a judge of the Court of Claims, and I would second the nomination. Thank you.
Along, congratulate Judge Cohen, who does have an outstanding record as a judge of the Court of Claims. Just quickly, Ed, as many of us know, there are people that we work with who oftentimes can make us much better at what we do. Judge Cohen is fortunate enough to have a lawman with him named Mr. Fagan, who has made him an even better judge. And all too often, we forget the people who work around are members of the judiciary. I just wanted to congratulate both of them. Thank you.
The question is on the motion to confirm the nomination of Mark D. Cohen to the Court of Claims. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No. Senator Foley will be recorded in the negative. The motion carries. The nomination is hereby confirmed.
Senator Diaz is a no. Senator Johnson is a no. Senator Diaz will also be recorded in the negative. Senator Klein.
Senator Johnson
will also be recorded in the negative. Senator Klein.
And I believe there's a report of the Finance Committee at the desk.
Senator Klein, there is a report of the Finance Committee at the desk. The Secretary will read.
Senator Krueger from the Committee on Finance reports the following nomination as a chairman and member of the State Liquor Authority, Dennis Rosen of Orchard Park.
Senator Krueger.
Mr. President, will we please move the nomination? Okay.
Are there any other senators wishing to be heard in the nomination? Senator Johnson.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. Just very briefly, I wish to second the nomination for Dennis Rosen for the chairman and member of the SLA, the State Liquor Authority. Mr. Rosen appeared before the Investigations Committee this morning. I got some very detailed responses to some very difficult questions. There's no doubt that this is a very challenging position, that the State Liquor Authority has hit some very troubled times. And I'm confident that with Mr. Rosen at its helm and under his leadership, we will see those better days that are much needed for this authority. So I wish him success. That success is desperately needed over there, and I congratulate him on his appointment. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Senator Johnson. The question is on the motion to confirm the nomination of Dennis.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I rise as well to speak on the nomination of Dennis Rosen for chair of the State Liquor Authority. This is unquestionably one of the single most important jobs in the state of New York. The chair of the State Liquor Authority and the State Liquor Authority oversee an arcane and often anachronistic body of law that affects small business owners across the state. It also affects communities in my district in a way that cannot be overstated. The profusion of liquor licenses, the inability to have a consistency that would work better, frankly, both for the small business owner and for the community, has been nothing short of a disaster in parts of my district across Lower Manhattan. I was pleased to get to meet Dennis Rosen over the phone, have an extensive conversation, speak to him at the Investigations Committee this morning. His openness and willingness to learn, his awareness of the significant challenges that the State Liquor Authority faces, and the incredibly urgent need for true reform is refreshing. I look forward to hosting him in my district, showing him some of the effects that the State Liquor Authority has had in my district, and look forward to working with him. I am very proud to vote in favor of him and look forward to many changes under his leadership at the State Liquor Authority. Thank you.
Senator Roback.
Yeah, yes, Mr. President. I, too, would like to congratulate Mr. Rosen on his appointment and say I'm looking forward to working with him. While sometimes people who aren't affected by SLA really don't know a whole lot about it, certainly in my community in Rochester, New York, and upstate New York, we are constantly on the phone with employees, really trying to move that process and certainly not circumvent anything, but shorten the waiting time it takes to get a business going, a license going, of someone who's been in operation for a while. So it's really going to become our mutual constituency, and wish you well in your new job and look forward to working with you.
Senator Nisolio.
Mr. President, I rise to support the nomination of Mr. Rosen to be a member of the State Liquor Authority and chairman of that important board. But I rise in support of him not because he's a graduate of the Harvard Law School, not because he had a distinguished career within the Attorney General's office in Western New York, but rather because he is the son of a small business owner. And his comments to me and to the committee at his appearance before the Senate Finance Committee, I believed, were telling and important. That he can focus on small business, and that's what we need to enhance in New York State, and look forward to working with the new chairman to ensure that our businesses, particularly those in the Finger Lakes region,
that depend on the tourist dollar can continue to help in New York's economy. I support this nomination. Thank you, Mr. President, for the opportunity to speak on its behalf.
Thank you, Senator Nozzolio. Senator Marcellino.
Yes, Mr. President. I also rise in support of Mr. Rosen's nomination. We had a conversation in the Finance Committee where I pointed out the problems of those of us who represent suburban communities where bars are located, and in many cases, in some cases, can be hot spots or spots where trouble arises. Gangs have moved into certain areas and claimed bars as their turf and created problems in our communities. I've been asking that the Liquor Authority, who is understaffed and needs help, and we hope to give it to them, gets out and works more closely with the local police precincts and with the local communities to rid our neighborhoods of these bars and locations where nothing but trouble occurs and nothing but no good actually happens. So we look forward to that. I intend to be on the phone with you, Mr. Rosen, with some frequency on that issue because it is a concern of mine and it is a concern of my constituents, and I look forward to working with you in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Marcellino. Senator Farley.
Thank you, Mr. President. I also rise to support Mr. Rosen for this position. This is one that every legislator in both houses works with this agency constantly, and of course, many times frustrated because of the delays and so forth. But basically, so much of this delay is caused by the fact that they are shorthanded, and something that we should recognize and be able to support that agency. But let me just say on the candidate that is before us, I don't think that anybody could be more suited for this position with the background that he has in the Attorney General's office, having served under several administrations and worked in the Attorney General's office. And I think that that makes for a great commissioner, and certainly he's eminently qualified and is with enthusiasm that I support his nomination.
Thank you, Senator Farley. Senator Volker.
Yes, Mr. President. Very quickly, Dennis Rosen is a constituent of mine from Western New York. He has served under a number of attorney generals. In fact, he was first appointed, I believe, under Dennis Vacco. His immediate superior, I believe, was my counsel, J.R. Drexilius. As I said at the meeting, part of the problem with the SLA, I don't believe that some of the people who died at the World Trade Center have been totally replaced. There were SLA people who died at the World Trade Center. It has been a vastly underfunded agency. It unfortunately is an agency which is rife for what's happening apparently in New York City, because when things are so delayed, certain things happen. This is something that the Bureau of the Budget should better look at, because it is a money gainer, not a money negative. One of the things we must understand is some business people don't understand that there are certain agencies that we need people to make us money, and the SLA is one of those. I wish you the best of luck, Dennis.
The question is on the nomination, to confirm the nomination of Dennis Rosen as a member of the, and chair of the State Liquor Authority. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The motion carries. The nomination is hereby confirmed. Dennis Rosen is in the gallery, and we all congratulate him, and I think all of us want him to do the best job imaginable. Senator Klein.
Mr. President, can we now please move to a reading of the calendar?
Secretary will read.
Calendar number 842 by member of the Assembly Weinstein. Assembly print number 8956A, an act to amend the civil practice law and rules.
Read the last section.
Section 7, this act shall take effect September 1, 2009.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skello, Smith, Young.
Announce the result.
Eyes.
speak. Senator Young, to explain her vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. The County Clerks Association has removed their opposition to this particular bill, but there still is some concern out there that this is an unfunded mandate for the counties, and therefore I vote no. Thank you.
Senator Young will be recorded in the negative. Announce the results.
Those recorded in the negative, on calendar number 842, are Senators Alisi, Griffo, Nozzolio, Seward, and Young. Ayes 51, nays 5.
The bill is passed. The Secretary will continue to read.
Calendar number 953 by Senator Sampson, Senate Print 5968.
Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 954 by Senator DeLon, Senate Print 6104, an act to amend the education law.
Read the last section. Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 955 by Senator Serrano, Senate Print 6105, an act to amend the education law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect on the same date and in the same manner as a chapter of the laws of 2009.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Senator Serrano to explain his vote.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I've been a staunch advocate for the arts over the years, especially arts education. And I strongly believe that the arts play a vital role in ensuring that our youth receive a well-balanced education that will provide them real opportunities in life. That's why I'm proud to sponsor this piece of legislation to create an arts advisory committee. The committee will provide oversight on arts education within the New York City school system. It will be empowered to advise and comment on all educational policy related to the arts, issue annual reports on the effectiveness of arts education in city schools, hold public meetings to help foster public debate and awareness regarding how to move arts education forward. And what makes this legislation empowering is that the advisory committee will also make recommendations for improvement. This means that the public dialogue is not a simple recital of problems, rather a discussion of focused and real methods New York City can employ to improve educational outcomes. I deem all aspects of this bill to be essential in moving arts education forward in advancing public awareness regarding the importance of arts in our children's education. While it cannot be denied that courses such as reading and math are critical to a child's education, I and many others believe that arts courses are critically important. It is important that we not make the mistake of thinking that the only critical courses are the ones linked to statewide testing standards. It has been proven time and time again with study after study that children who are taught music and art do far better in courses like reading and math. The arts also opens the door for better cognitive thinking and awakens passions for self-expression and individual thinking, attributes that will foster our next generation of great thinkers and leaders. It is well documented that arts education provides students with the ability to develop a number of critical skills, skills like self-discipline, teamwork, problem solving, and the list goes on and on. Such skills are critical not only to scholastic and academic success, but also to future workforce success. In today's world, when young people can expect to have jobs in more than one field and work with colleagues from different parts of the world, these skills are essential. There are state requirements on the books, but they are not being met. In New York City in the 2007-2008 school year, according to the DOE, only 8% of elementary schools were in a position to meet the minimum requirements established by the state by offering all four arts forms in each grade. And less than half of middle schools met the state requirements. These numbers are abysmal, yet with proper oversight, they went largely unnoticed. As one might expect, these compliance statistics are especially appalling in communities with a high concentration of low-income families, many of which fall into my own district in East Harlem and the South Bronx. It should not matter if a student resides on 104th Street or 84th Street. Access to arts in schools must not be dependent upon where a student lives and income of the student's parents. By creating this advisory committee, there will be a mechanism in place to identify the lack of compliance with arts education standards, and more importantly, develop sufficient remedy. While I stand here on the Senate floor, I can't help but think about all the arts and music teachers who work hard every day and fight for the resources needed to teach their craft to their eager students. They never give up hope, that they'll be able to reach inside that young person's mind and help flip the switch that will awaken a lifetime love for the arts and music and a passion for what is truly beautiful in this world. I think about the late, great Fred Darris, who for generations taught everything from classical music to Shakespeare in students of the South Bronx at Berger Junior High School. His tireless efforts helped create eventual leaders, one of them who is my father. Through Fred Darris, I learned firsthand at a very young age how to translate countless positive things outside the classroom may help change what happens in the street. To be clear, there is a lot of work to be done, both in the city and state level, to ensure arts education is getting the attention it deserves. We must continue to look for new ways to ensure that children get the type of quality education. And still, this legislation is a very step forward. It's a very important step forward, and I'm proud to stand here to sponsor it. I'd like to thank advocates who helped, such as the Center for Arts Education and the New York State Alliance for Arts Education. Finally, I'd like to thank Mayor Bloomberg and Deputy Mayor Walcott for their commitment to arts education, and I look forward to viewing this legislation as a starting point to help greater enforcement for arts in the classroom. Thank you. I vote yes.
Thank you, Senator Serrano. Senator Serrano will be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Perkins to explain his vote.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. First, let me begin by commending my colleague, Senator Serrano, for his visionary and understanding of the role that arts plays in the child's development, especially in our educational system, when it is not in the context of male control. However, in that context, it does not get the chance to flourish and provide all those wonderful things that my colleague just pointed out. And so for that reason, as well as because the advocates such as the Center for Arts Education have determined that this particular approach will not be as effective as I think Senator Serrano has had in mind. And so I'm going to have to vote no on this resolution. In fact, I will say now that I'll be voting on no on all the resolutions because, again, I believe that in the context of male control, that the intention and the vision that these have will be crippled and that what we hope to achieve will not be achieved. So thank you very much. I vote no.
In the negative, announce the results.
Ayes 55, nays 1. Senator Perkins recorded in the negative.
The bill is passed. Secretary will continue to read.
Calendar number 956 by Senator Adams, Senate Print 6106, an act to amend the education law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect on the same date and in the same.
Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 957 by Senator Huntley, Senate Print 6107, an act to amend the education law.
Secretary will read.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skello, Smith, Young.
Senator Salam to explain his vote.
President, Mr. President, certainly the purpose of this bill is clear, and while I may question the necessity for the kind of training center in each of the boroughs that the bill provides, I'm more concerned about the last paragraph in the bill, which makes reference to the City of New York providing annual funding to the center in an amount equal to that provided in an appropriation by the state, but not to exceed $800,000 per year. I'm not exactly certain what that obligates the state to do, whether in fact it obligates an appropriation by the state. I'm not exactly sure what happens if the cost of these centers exceeds some $800,000, if that somehow or other is going to result in yet additional appropriations being required of the state. I realize the Assembly hasn't acted on this bill yet, but it may well. And given the fiscal crisis that we find ourselves in at this particular time, anticipating coming back within the next month or two, having any number of bills that have been vetoed for appropriations not provided for in the budget, I'm going to cast my vote in the negative on this. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Saland. Senator Saland will be recorded in the negative. Announce the results.
Those recorded.
Senator Perkins to explain his vote.
Again, thank you, Mr. President. I'm going to be voting no again on this. There's nothing more important than the involvement of parents and the empowerment of parents in this process of educating our children. Male control, as we have come to know it, is male dictatorship, and parents have been crippled to the point of tears and outrage about the fact that they are not, and this bill, unfortunately, in that context, will not give them the opportunity to play a meaningful role. And in fact, I have received numerous complaints from parents that have asked me to make sure that we do not allow mayoral control to be continued. Of course, we'll do what we can towards that end, but nevertheless, it is clear, at least in my district, that what we have been experiencing has been a horrible thing for parents and their involvement, and especially in the context of something called mayoral control as it is being proposed and as these amendments will be attached. I should also point out to you that I have also received numerous phone calls from my constituents. Thank you for voting against mayoral control. There is a robocall saying that your vote condemns our children. She doesn't agree and should. And they want us to make sure that we vote against mayoral control. And so even as the mayor has attempted to get our communities to come out against us, it has backfired because the calls that I got, the numerous calls that I got, were telling me not to be supportive. So again, I'm going to be voting no, and I hope that my colleagues understand that I agree with them in terms of the importance, but this is not the way that my constituency feels that it can be achieved.
Thank you, Senator Perkins. Senator Perkins will be recorded in the negative. Senator Diaz to explain his vote.
Just to let you know, Mr. President, that I'm joining my colleague, Senator Perkins, and I'm going to take advantage of his explanation to make it mine, and also to let you know that in the previous bill, 955, I'm also voting no, and I'm joining my colleague from Manhattan and the Bronx united against this thing. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Diaz. Senator Diaz will be recorded in the negative. All right. Announce the results. Announce the results.
Those recorded in the negative on calendar number 957 are Senators Bonasek, Diaz, Flanagan, Griffo, O. Johnson, Lanza, Maziarz, Nozzolio, Perkins, Ranzenhofer, Robach, Saland, and Young. Also Senators Larkin and Morahan. Ayes 41, nays 15.
The bill is passed. Senator Marcelino.
President, can we withdraw at this time the last slides on calendar numbers 954 and 956 and have those bills returned to the non-controversial reading?
Bills 956 and 954 will be restored to the non-controversial reading. And we will continue with bill calendar number 954. Secretary will read.
Calendar number 954 by Senator DeLon, Senate Print 6104, an act to amend the education law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect on the same date and in the same manner as a chapter of the laws of 2009.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Those recorded in the negative on calendar number 954 are Senators Diaz and Perkins. Ayes 54, nays 2.
The bill is passed. Secretary will continue to read.
Calendar number 956 by Senator Adams, Senate Print 6106, an act to amend the education law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect on the same date and in the same manner as a chapter of the laws of 2009.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skelo, Smith, Young.
Announce the results. Senator Perkins to explain his vote.
Again, I want to commend my colleague, Senator Adams, and company for their very, very important concern and interest in the safety of our children. Clearly, that is very, very important to all of us. However, you know, as we are presently managing safety in our public schools in New York City, it is effectively putting into the closet the role of the educators, the principals and the teachers and related staff who have and often been in confrontation in that arena, and there has been instances, too many instances, in which police action was taken when other types of actions did not need to be taken. Our schools are beginning to almost look like steps towards prison because of the fact that it's so much policing of that type being done when, in fact, we don't need the police necessarily to do it, that there are other ways that can be done, and so, again, this is an idea that I think is important, but in the context, especially of mayor control, the type of dictatorship that we've seen, I cannot support it, and I will be voting no.
Thank you, Senator Perkins. Senator Perkins will be recorded in the negative. Senator Adams to explain his vote.
Oh, thank you, Mr. President. And I thank you, Senator Perkins. And I want to really take a moment to thank, as I explain my vote, my colleagues on the other side of the aisle, particularly Senator Lanza, for really understanding why this issue was so important to us. And some of the calls we received as we debated this issue several weeks ago, they understood that these chapter amendments were important. And they understood why there was a lot of discussions, and this was a very tense argument. And I just want to especially acknowledge with Senator Huntley and Senator DeLine and the conference leader, Senator Sampson, of trying to put together a very difficult issue. And the most important part of this issue, as I spoke with some of my colleagues on the other side of the aisle, is that we're now in a position where we have a committee that can raise the questions. Because the only thing we want is for our children to be educated. It doesn't matter who's the mayor that's doing it. It doesn't matter what process is put in place. As long as we know that the numbers that are put before us are the real numbers, and we're not using Bernie Madoff type math to take away the future of our children. If the numbers are correct, then we will all see them and the transparency we're getting. This amendment that I put forward is dealing with public safety. Public safety starts with a conversation. We don't want our children in small fights. I don't know anyone in here that didn't get into some form of a fight in school. I had three. And if I was arrested each time I pushed someone or did something inappropriate, I would not have become a police officer. So I want to thank all of us for coming together, finding a resolution, continuing the process of educating our children, and a special note to my friend in the rafters, Deputy Mayor Walcott, for his commitment to the education of our children. This is an important issue. This is important to us all. And that's why there was so much passion and so much tension around this issue. And again, I will be voting in affirmative on this amendment.
Thank you, Senator Adams. Senator Adams will be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
Those recorded in the negative on calendar number 956 are Senators Diaz, Griffo, and Perkins. Ayes 53, nays 3.
Secretary will read. The bill is passed.
In relation to calendar number 958,
up Bill 958, which in your book is listed as improperly or incorrectly as 952.
Calendar number 958, Senator Padovan moves to discharge from the Committee on Rules Assembly Bill number 8903A and substitute it for the identical Senate Bill number 5887, third reading calendar 958.
Bill is laid aside. Substitution ordered.
Bill is laid aside.
Bill is laid aside. Senator Klein.
President, at this time, can we please move to a reading of the controversial calendar?
Yes. The secretary will please ring the bell.
The secretary will please ring the bell. Controversial calendar.
Members are asked to come to the chamber.
Members are to be called to the chamber. Look at Senator Diaz. Announce calendar 953. Secretary will read.
Calendar number 953 by Senator Sampson, Senate Print 5968, an act to amend the Family Court Act.
The bill is laid aside for the day. Secretary will continue to read.
Calendar number 958, substituted earlier by member of the Assembly Silver, Assembly Print number 8903A, an act to amend the education law.
Read the last section.
Yeah, it's a controversial bill. Ask Senator Squadron if he wants to speak on the bill.
Senator Squadron, would you like to speak on the bill?
President, I appreciate it. I know Senator Padovan will also be speaking to explain the bill. I wanted to just explain this bill briefly. There's no question, and we all say, that education is the most important. Education in New York City particularly, 1.1 million school children, a larger school system than most states in this country. And I think that there's no question, if you look at it, there's been a lot of good work for those 1.1 million school children over the last 7 years. And I think if you look at it, there's no question that there's a lot of work still to do. The challenge we faced this year was how do you keep the progress going while improving in the ways that improvements were needed? How do you add transparency and parental input while maintaining that strict accountability to the mayor that the school governance bill passed 7 years ago, the quote-unquote mayoral control, does? I think this bill does that perfectly. Unlike some of the reports out there, this is not just a strict extender of what we already have in the system. This improves the system in significant ways. Local superintendents will appear back in local districts in a way they haven't been in years. They're required in this bill to be in the districts. They have real authority in the schools. The community education councils, the parent bodies, actually have a say in who the superintendents are, have a voice with the chancellor in choosing those superintendents. That is a big improvement. We're going to have local offices, local say in a way we haven't had. Those CECs, those parent education councils, are beefed up in significant ways. Not just as eligibility expanded for them, which it is, but there's new hearing requirements anytime there's a change in use of schools or a school opens or closes with those CECs. And as I said before, they have a real say with those superintendents. We're not going to have CECs, community education councils, that are just rubber stamps or sort of defunct. They're going to have a real role that gives parents a real official voice. That is a great improvement to the law. When you look at the public process more broadly, there is a robust public process in this bill. You have it on the local level with the community education councils. You also have it at the citywide level through the Panel for Educational Policy. Much has been made of what is this role for the Panel for Educational Policy? Well, I think in this bill, the role is made very, very clear. It is a process for public input, for transparency. They have a requirement to publish their agendas 10 days ahead of time. They have a 45-day waiting requirement for any number of significant decisions of the chancellors. The Panel for Educational Policy's role is clarified, is rationalized, and is meaningful. It is going to be an effective voice for transparency citywide. Procurement and contracts, been talked about a whole lot. This might be the tightest procurement system in the state of New York that the New York City Department of Education is now going to have, and that's a good thing. That's going to work well. It is a $15 billion budget. Hopefully it'll continue to be a $15 billion budget and in fact grow so we continue to invest in our kids. And as it grows, we need to make sure the money's being spent well. This procurement policy will do that. The New York City Comptroller has real authority now in the Department of Education, just like any other city agency. That's a good thing. There was no reason for the department to kind of fall into a netherworld between the city and the state. That happened too often in the past. It's not going to happen in the future. The Independent Budget Office of New York City, which has proven to be an independent, strong voice, oversight on City Hall, both the council and the mayor, is going to get extra funding, is going to have the ability not just to look at the budget of DOE, but also at a whole lot of those educational metrics. All of these questions are out there. What does this educational number mean? What does the graduation rate mean? Well, the IBO is going to have the ability to get in there, get those raw numbers, and make real definitive judgments and statements, real substantive analysis. That is incredibly important. And we now are going to have educational impact statements that the chancellor needs to put out there on any number of issues, from the students with special needs to needs of communities. That's going to get out there early in the process. That's going to help every step of this process, from the local one to the citywide one. It changes the dynamic between the chancellor and the communities, between the department and the public at large. That is a good thing. Two of these, I proposed two ideas this spring. One was something called the UPEP, the Universal Parent Engagement Procedure, an idea originally proposed by Borough President Scott Stringer of Manhattan. It was a great way to create exactly the process that we see in this bill. I am pleased to see those ideas in the bill that hopefully we will pass today. I also proposed a bill that would very clearly make the Department of Education a city agency. Not every piece of that bill is in this one, but I gotta tell you, as I said earlier, the Department of Education no longer falls into a netherworld between the city and the state. When it comes to the comptroller, when it comes to the IBO, when it comes to procurement, it's very clear what the role, what the relationship of the Department of Education to other city and state agencies is. That's a very, very, very good thing. So this bill, in significant ways, improves the law. I don't think there's any question. And it does it without undermining the central tenet that we needed to preserve, which is clear line of accountability to the mayor. The mayor needs to have the ability and the responsibility to change the system, to close the achievement gap that persists, and to improve public education on a broad scale in an urban setting. Certainly, as I said at the beginning, I think real progress has been made in the last 7 years. Graduation rates in the city of New York are up. Test scores, as against other big cities in the state of New York, are up. Those are terribly important numbers. For many, many parents, the system, their local school, their local neighborhood, is so much more responsive and effective than it ever was in the past. That matters. But of course, there's still much to do. We haven't solved the problem of urban education in the last 7 years. The achievement gap persists, as I said. Graduation rates, while up, are nowhere near where they need to be. I worry about how we're educating English language learners and special education students. They're still not achieving anywhere near at the level they have to. I believe that there's a greater role for assessments, educational assessments, outside of the anachronistic fill-in-the-bubble test that we're still much too dependent on. I don't believe that the role of arts education or of civics is yet significant enough in the city of New York and has to be more significant. But the fact is, overall, in the last 7 years, the system of education for New York City school children has gotten better across the city. And this bill that we are passing today improves on that system. It places the responsibility for future improvement when it comes to the achievement gap, when it comes to arts and civics, when it comes to graduation rates, when it comes to parental engagement with New York City's mayor. There's no question about that. It's his or her responsibility to keep the progress going and, frankly, take it a whole lot farther. But the formula that we are passing today in this bill, accountability combined with transparency and parental input, regardless of all of the Albany power struggles and all of the craziness that happens up here, that formula will give the 1.1 million children down in New York City the best possible chance to go to schools that will give them the best possible chance to succeed in life. That's why I'm proud to be the first co-sponsor of this bill, and I'll be supporting it. Thank you very much, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Squadron. Senator Padovan.
Thank you, Mr. President. And thank you, Senator Squadron, for your very, very articulate and comprehensive outline of this bill. You hit many of the very significant areas that I think have preoccupied this legislature, not only this year, but for decades. One of the first things that was handed to me when I arrived here 37 years ago was something called the Fleischman Report. Years later, there was the Markey Commission. Nothing has preoccupied the state legislature more than governance and the Department of Education, the former Board of Education in the city of New York. During the past 9 months, a great deal of study and analysis has been done relevant to the effectiveness of mayoralty control, which began in 2002. Whether it's the Citizens Union or the Public Advocate or the CSA, the principals who certainly are there every day in our schools, who know certainly whether or not the experiment was valid and productive, the teachers in the classroom, all of them, without exception, urged us to continue mayoralty control and that form of governance which we've had for the last 7 years. The bill before us passed the Assembly 129-18, with 70% of the assemblymen from the city of New York voting for it. Clear indication at the grassroots level of support for what has been going on for the past 7 years. Now, it isn't just governance, because as the Senator indicated, we have authority married with responsibility. And what that engenders more than anything else is resources. Embedded in the 2000 law and in continued in this one is maintenance of effort. Those of you know, I'm sure, know what that is. To ensure that the city of New York maintains its level of funding consistent with what we have been doing here for the past decade at the state level. And it's worked. We're now spending well over $16,000 per pupil in the city of New York, more than any school system in any city or state in the nation on a per capita basis. On top of that, because this mayor was on the hook, he came up with a five-year capital program of over $13 billion, where we're building schools at every borough, modernizing them, upgrading them, expanding them. There isn't a school area or any district in the city where you don't find scaffolding or work being done. So our children and our teachers, employees, 130,000 of them, who go to work every day, 1.1 million children into those schools, find an environment which I think is far better than it has ever been and certainly contributes to the quality of the education they get. There is a sunset in this bill, 2015, and there's no doubt in my mind that whatever legislature is here, those of us who are here, we will be having a similar discussion, looking back at a six-year period and saying, well, are the changes that we put in place from 2002, are they beneficial? Have they done the job? Have they improved the product? And then make another judgment. I think that we will come up with the answer of yes. Senate Squadron indicated the concerns with English language learners. One of the things in this bill is a new citywide council just for that purpose. He talked at great length, and properly so, about the auditing and oversight. The control of the City of New York and the Office of the Budget Office all will have access to all the data and contracts and oversight that goes on in the Department of Education. We could be here all afternoon, and I know that many of you'd like to get back home. I'm going to end with one of the letters that I got a copy of from the Department of Education, written by the U.S. Secretary of Education, Mr. Duncan. As President Obama's Secretary of Education, I can tell you that both the change and the resulting progress that has occurred in New York City schools over the last 7 years is truly remarkable. I believe, whether it's remarkable or outstanding or positive, whatever adjective you'd like to use, we did the right thing 7 years ago. And hopefully we'll do the right thing again today by keeping this thing moving forward with all the improvements that have been articulated, and I will repeat them, particularly the area of superintendents, which is something we fought for. Senator Lanz and myself, Senator Golan, had three or four meetings with the chancellor, and that's what we talked about most of all. We've got to give those superintendents the opportunity in their districts to do their job and not be sent all over the city doing things that are not relevant to their district, and give them the resources to do it. 90% of the problems at the district level can be handled in that office if given the opportunity to do so. So there are tons of things in here. You all got the fact sheet. You can read them. I need to read them to you. But we've done a good job, I think, together, both houses, working, ironing out, accepting inputs and recommendations, and we're here today to vote on the bill. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Padovan.